This first day surely goes by so fast. Yeah, this is next to the last talk for today. Okay, Pavle is here with us, and he will talk about the role of backend development in Web3. So I really can't wait to hear the perspective of Web3 from an experienced developer. Please post your questions through Whova. Of course, don't hesitate to raise your hand if Pavle leaves enough time. And make sure to visit the Decenter booth upstairs, and yeah, you can bring those questions there too. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Test, test, one, two. Hello, everyone. My name is Pavle. I'm the new cookie of the backend team in the center. So I've been there slightly less than a year, which actually makes me uniquely qualified. I know, fancy words. To address the topic of this talk today, and that is not because I come near to being fancy. I'm a backend engineer after all, right? It's rather I'm not that deep and not that long into Web3 to forget how it actually looks sometimes from the outside. And I would be most happy if I'm kind of completely wrong about this talk and the whole point of this. So I suspect there's a fear and some sort of a blockage for developers to make a deep dive into Web3. So especially for the seniors who get comfortable in their spots, and I don't mean that as a bad thing. Rather, we need you guys. We need your expertise and your contributions. Sometimes Web3 can leave isolated vibe that we're somehow isolated somewhere, or even worse, false, we're so better than Web2 vibe, which really anyone decent that's working here isn't like that. So it's really harder than it needs to be. The transition is harder, and I'm also suffering under the learning curve, but it's up to us to make it better and to kind of smooth it out, but we need time and we need feedback. So I guess you're pretty all familiar with Java, and Java is kind of older than Joe Biden, which is hard to be. Spring isn't that young either, and all that meaning in a really, really good sense. So the frameworks have evolved so much, and not only those two, of course, all the other technologies and all the other frameworks that are really battle-hardened, they have evolved so much that it's really hard to do something wrong. It's really, you have to try, in a way. Even Hibernate, which is a framework used by a framework, and it's a persistence-only framework, is 2 decades old. So as you can imagine, everything is chewed out and spat out n times m times. So you have so many documentations, so many answers, and so many problems that have already been answered for you. So when it's so hard to make a mistake, also the documentation follows everything, it kind of constrains you to do it by the book, and doing by the book may be a good thing or not. That's not a topic for today. So when I was starting my dev career, I was working with Spring, Java at one point, with Kotlin as well, and it's really wonderful. And it was relatively simple to follow the pattern. I rarely, if at all, stumbled upon a problem that hasn't been solved or answered on Stack Overflow. Reading my senior mentor's code and doing some basic tutorials, I could make a relatively organized controller service repository layered architecture, most of the time setting it up right. Of course, the classes weren't that solid, you know, solid principles. I know I showed myself out. So for example, also, forgive me if I'm wrong, but .NET doesn't allow you to do dependency injection if you don't have an interface, which has to be implemented, as simple as that might as it might be. My point being, either if you're a junior just starting his gig, the first footsteps, or you're a senior that's making a transition to another environment, everything is prepared for you, and it's not that hard. All the environments are older than most of us here, which is awesome. Like, everything is battle-tested. It's hard to make a mistake. It will teach you how to do it right, even if you don't know it. Because everything is prepared, a framework like Hibernate handles database issues that you actually don't know exist. So in Web3, we don't have that luxury, unfortunately. We're the pioneers of it all, which is also really fun. So if you think technology is evolving fast, and we all think that, if you pour some steroids into it, you get the speed of Web3 development. And it's a bit wild, true. But it's normal. It's new. It's a youngling. Over time, it will mostly slow down, just like everything else does. I'm quite confident, even though I'm a bit young, that Java 5 was much easier to develop than Java 17 because of the promise of backwards compatibility. The same feature will arrive here at some point in time, just over iterations, and the documentations and the frameworks will catch up, and everything will be OK. And my point being is don't wait that much to hop on into that wild train. The sooner you do it, the better. It's really fun. So one really important question. Do you remember the excitement, that mega, mega excitement of programming, you know, when you were in college or somewhere else? I have forgotten it. You might have as well. I'm not 15 years in the industry. That joy you have when you're in college or you're beginning your software engineer gig and you create something, it has a business value, it has some other value, and you're like, oh, this is so awesome. I'm so excited. I have created something. I have created my Eiffel Tower. I'm the creator. So I remember the first biggish feature I did on our product. I'll tell you a bit more about the product later on. I was implementing something we call a strategy. I was pairing with our team lead. He had to help me really a bunch because of the web3 gap I had. And thank you very much to the camera. We were trying, we were erring, we were failing, sometimes succeeding. And at one point, we managed to run that strategy on a test network, meaning blockchain. And well, it has passed. Like all the details were there. I could open the transaction preview. I could see everything. Everything went where it should be. All the checks have been done. The verification has been done. The transaction has been processed by our system. And everything was so cool. I was so happy. Like I literally said to my team lead, hey, man, I need to make a 25-minute break. I need to go for a walk because I couldn't sit in one spot. I was so excited that I finally created something so cool and I could already envision something on the blockchain and I could understand the purpose of it in a way. So, yeah. And that's maybe the biggest encouragement I can actually give you is the excitement behind it for you to hop in, at least technology-wise. Web3 and blockchain also bring a bunch of other things with it. One of the most notable is the decentralization culture. We want to give freedom and ownership to both us and our users. And I guess I can feel the skepticism from here when I say something like that, which is really fine. I was like that in the beginning as well. So when you combine culture with the technology challenges it brings, it really makes a joyful software engineering day and experience that you can have. But let's stick a bit more to technology and backend. So I guess the first order of business would be to go through why we work on a chain that has gained so much popularity, even though its native token doesn't value as much as Bitcoin does in US dollars. Yes, I'm talking about Ethereum. Let me just, of course, briefly cover what is a blockchain. In the most simple terms, you can view a blockchain as a append-only database. Yeah, that's a good description. It's made of blocks, where each block points to the previous one, and so it goes. And each block contains a set of state changes that has been applied to the blockchain, transfers or something else. So to explain how we got to Ethereum, we have to go through Bitcoin as well. Bitcoin as a blockchain is super cool, not disputable. Though Bitcoin has one big intentional constraint on it, and that is it's not really allowing big expansions in the software development world. It's just a big state machine that offers ownership of tokens. A bit more than that, true, but it's really only a bit. So around 10 years ago, or actually 2023, so 10 years ago, 2013, Vitalik Buterin, a Bitcoin-loving programmer, decided that he wanted to face on this challenge. And that ended up in a proposed white paper for Ethereum. The goal and the reason for birth of Ethereum is to solve the constraints of Bitcoin without going off-chain, as we say, going to more centralization, more hidden AWS servers that you don't know what's happening around there. And blockchain as an idea brings the transparency and trust, and decentralization is not some feature you have there. It's on a culture level, really. And Ethereum is as well a state machine, don't get me wrong, but it offers us something else. It offers us to store data and programs on-chain that can be executed by other users of Ethereum. Those are called smart contracts. Basically, the idea was to create a general purpose blockchain where you developers or you users decide how do you want to actually use it. And the freedom is up to you. If you want to, I don't know, make a variable that you want to manually increment every time, that is also perfectly fine. But you can program whole protocols and whole organizations and deploy them on-chain. So basically what you get is one huge singleton virtual machine that doesn't lie and hide, which is as much as it is useful and as much as it is fun, it's dangerous, really. In my opinion, ignorance is actually one of the biggest problems that blockchain has. Not being educated can lead you to making really costly mistakes, and you don't have to be a super mega experienced Solidity engineer. You just at least have to know how to handle your wallet. So, again, it's up to us to improve it, and over time, and feedback and more help will be better and better. So over time, the general purpose blockchain started evolving. It gave birth to something called a dApp culture, or better said, decentralized applications. You don't have to have a central server that will process some amount of data. You can actually go only front-end and blockchain, using blockchain as a big state machine and a source of information, or even to process some items for you, skipping backend completely, actually. So moving on, the developer culture of Ethereum. It's slightly different than in Bitcoin. Bitcoin is following more the Java approach, promising backwards compatibility. When it makes some changes, it offers the clients, hey, do you want to opt in or not? And that's basically it. Ethereum goes on a more widely path. It doesn't offer the promise of backward compatibility. And that doesn't really mean that its developers want to break your stuff and leave you hanging. Rather, the issue that is being solved has the utmost priority. So if the issue being solved brings enough value with it, the backward compatibility will be broken. Meaning, for us, that we have to design our systems with lower complexity and have the enough flexibility to rapidly follow those changes. You have to modularize it well. If you fail to do so, you will be in big trouble. So since we are kind of limited by time, right, and I can't bombard you with everything, I just use a moment to talk with something that is quite commonly mentioned when you have a topic such as blockchain, and that is a transaction. We can view a transaction as a simple transfer of funds between user accounts or contracts even. A contract can also own tokens or a set of code that is being executed, though always by user invocation. A smart contract can't go like, hey, I woke up, I'm going to do stuff. So you have to invoke it, and then it can invoke other contracts and have a cascading effect. A transaction is also decorated with a few of following items. You have a creator, you're creating this transaction and submitting it. You have to have a recipient, so when you open the explorers, you always see who created and who is receiving the transaction. We have a gas price, a gas limit, and we have data. Data is like a REST JSON counterpart in a way, right? And a few others, but that doesn't matter. Only mentioning a transaction, we had to mention gas, so let me walk you through it. Every transaction on blockchain has a price. It's not free to run. You can run some simple read queries on the blockchain without a price, that's okay, but you can't modify its state for free. There is a protection in place to prevent any malicious occupying of the computer, because remember, it's a one big, huge computer. So if there were no limitations, I could just make an infinite for loop and, well, that's it, Ethereum died. Gas protects us from exactly something like this. And if you do a high level of iterations and a huge load of changes, it will cost you a lot of money. But this is actually the technical fun that is kind of bringing it back. It's a bit of a back to the future moment, because you really have to mind your resources. It's not like I think today you can, I don't know, write 25 join tables in 4 different queries, go .get.get.get.all, and you don't mind because, well, it's on mxlarge and AWS, and who cares? So here you have to be careful what are you doing, and it's kind of really fun. So to explain gas a bit more, gas price is the actual price you pay per computation unit, and gas limit would be how many computations unit you're willing to spend. To make a parallel with cars, because that's what it reminds you of, gas price is the $2 you pay per liter when you pour it in, and gas limit is the amount of liters you're willing to spend to get somewhere. So, as you see, it's already starting to gain some complexity around it. Before we go on, I would like to talk a bit more about what we make. And since this is not a blockchain course, I'll try to make it simple. I'll try to do it, but it's really hard because when I want to say something really small about blockchain, I also have to bring a bustle of the context with it, like you saw at the previous moment. And don't worry, HR is not forcing me to do this. This is my own free will, and the rest I have to say. But it's nice to spread the word. I'm just kidding. So we are making a product called DeFi Saver. You can view our platform as a spot to manage your DeFi assets and positions. We aggregate a decent amount of DeFi protocols. In case you're not into it, a DeFi protocol is something similar to a stock market, the most plainly put. And our app is, in a way, a one-stop shop. So on our platform, where you can manage your positions, a position is, most plainly put, you putting some token as a collateral and maybe taking some other as a borrow value to utilize the price changing dynamic that's happening right now. Or you can do something else, really. You can just deposit for passive savings and incomes, or you can exchange for token A to token B. I remember when I was viewing the product for my first time, you know, my job is starting, I want to get ahead of onboarding and I want to see and get myself familiar. I was staring at a screen for 5 minutes trying to figure out where the login button is. So that's actually where Web3 beauty kind of comes in. We don't care about your email, password, your date of birth, and how many siblings you have. Is your father older than your mother? What car you drive? How frequent do you sleep? How frequent do you shower? Or everything else does what Google gathers for you. You simply log in with your wallet, and that's it. You rock on. To maybe make a better picture, if you want, you can scan this QR code. Don't worry, it's not a Ponzi to get you to do something. It will take you to our app, where Vitalik Buterin's address is in a preview mode. I took the liberty of sharing this because I'm 100% confident anyone that is poking around this will do the same. Hey, let's check Vitalik out. I was the first one to do that, so that's really normal. I'll just wait a few more seconds if everyone is scanning. Okay, everything I talk so far is the front-end team's job. But I'm here to talk about back-end, you know, because it's better. Just kidding. If I showed you my front-end visual skills, you would all leave immediately. To activate the back-end team as a user, you subscribe to our automation feature. Automation is there to allow you to leave your house and not be in fear. What if the Ether price drops and I lose my position, I lose all my assets, or what if the Ether price rises and I want to gain that and make a leverage out of it to even gain more funds? So you subscribe to strategies, as I mentioned before. A strategy is basically, you can view it as a query string. If a token X rises or drops to Y, do it set, though it's a predefined list. Our job is to make that happen. We monitor the market for you, and when a trigger aligns with your desired values, we submit a transaction for you, protecting your assets or hopefully helping you earn more funds. As you can imagine, availability is a must-have for us, and we're really obsessed with fail-safes upon fail-safes upon fail-safes. And we'll always like to see this, like, enjoy your vacation. You see my T-shirt? You can drive a car near the palm trees and don't care. So let's start getting into technicalities. This is where you can see that you can actually really easily hop on into Web3 backend development. So here, I'll show you what's under the hood and get ready. Oh, wow, HTTP and REST, who would have said? Postgres and Kafka, wow, is this blockchain? AWS and their configurations, they have screwed us up again. You know, when you forget to add some permission or something like that. So it's really a bunch of normal Web2 stuff. I can safely say that the Web3 specifics are in the minority. Not meaning they're easy or that there isn't a lot to worry about. Our whole product revolves around it. But if I could run some sort of a coverage covering our code base, the Web3 related stuff comparing to normal stuff, I believe it would be maybe 95.5% difference, or 90.10, I'm not sure. So really, we use Kafka like everyone else. We use Postgres like everyone else. We make REST calls with the old good buddy HTTP. We struggle with microservices and how to separate them. We get pissed at some AWS rules and setups and everything. We swear when SonarQube comes here and just spits on you because you have more than allowed maximum complexity and everything else you face in your day. A great deal of time is just spending what you do in your everyday life, really. You make an HTTP request, it gets a bad status code. If it's that bad, you get an alarm for it. Then you log in into your code, oh, what's happening? And you're like, oh my God, how can I have been so stupid? I put the wrong ID. And that's really normal. Most of the day, I develop, debug, and discuss everyday software engineering issues. We use the same principles and patterns as everyone else. Though luckily, that is not all. We also have to have the privilege to break our heads on Ethereum problems. We have to calculate gas. We have to see how to optimize it. We have to try to find the best possible way to pack that transaction for our users' benefit. And we'll do so on our tab as well. For example, if your transaction is estimated by us that it will cost $10, but it actually costs $20, the fee we charge will be on the $10. We won't charge you for the other 10. And we give the utmost priority to our transaction passing. Otherwise, our user could be really endangered, and he relied on us. He went on a vacation. We collaborate closely with our Solidity team, but yet again, they really don't ease the path for us. Short description, Solidity is a language for programming on blockchain. Since our user comes first, the security checks are the most important security checks are on Solidity level. Meaning, even if we wanted to be fraudulent and send a different transaction that the user intended, we couldn't do so. It would be checked on Solidity, and it would be really a failure. So we really see that our user is protected all around. So we view that as a healthy Web3 environment where the protections are open source and everyone can see them, and they're on chain, they have been submitted. And even though we all share the same company roof, we have that dynamic between the teams. So let's talk a bit more about the challenges we face and how it looks to maintain a backend system in Web3. We will go over a probably not complete list of things we have to support. Let's call it a requirement list in a way. And before we go on, I have to share with you something that I find really amazing is the human creativity. You would be amazed how cool of a solutions people figure out and how smart it is and how simply the human creativity. But also, you would be amazed how the human creativity will fuck you up. Like, it's amazing what would they come up with just to make damage to you and to be malicious. Okay, the list. Availability and resilience. Users expect our 24/7 support, and we don't have a big of a team that we work 24/7, so we have to be available always. We have to have backups. We have to be resilient, robust, and we really put high amount of priority on that. Price fetching, monitoring, and request handling, I guess that's normal for all backends. We constantly bombard ourselves with price requests because we're monitoring the market, right? But also, our users do the same because they want to check their positions, want to check something else. The monitoring and request handling comes with it. Security is an interesting topic in blockchain. It's slightly different than what you would encounter in real life. Blockchain is a big help out because everything works through transactions, and all you need is your wallet. A lot of the security is natively already on blockchain, so you don't need to worry about fancy JVT tokens and refresh tokens and role-based access and in the end evolving something like key clock and break your head how to set it up. Been there, done that. Service security, typical things like who and when and how can sign a transaction, we have to be really careful about that. And among other things, I just wanted to mention something really unfortunately cool, I guess. Those are the MEV attacks. One of the famous ones is the sandwich attack. Basically, you will submit a transaction to your leverage to utilize the current situation, and a bot somewhere watching your transaction, because Ethereum is public, right? The transaction pool is public as well, would see that you have submitted your transaction. He would make the same transaction, just maybe he would just add just a bit more gas, offer more gas money, let's call it like that. So his transaction goes first, only before yours. And then your goes after not receiving the expected result because the market has already been shifted. And then it can also make another transaction coming third in the line after yours, basically just to scoop up the leftovers, or as we would say, pokupiti kaimak, right? So there's the creativity of the humans. Gas and its costs is something we also have to worry about constantly. You can optimize how much gas you're going to spend, but you can't predict the market about the gas prices. Transaction failure. What if the transaction fails? Are we going to try again? Have we missed the opportunity? What is the user going to think? How that really works? Monitoring and analysis. I know I'm saying monitoring again, but this is slightly different because we constantly have to be keeping track of the transactions that all around that are ours. What if we have to boost it so it has to pass? What if we have to notify the user? What if we have to notify ourselves? We have to have a mass preview of data, of triggers, subscriptions, transactions, what is executed, what is not executed, especially for something like tax calculation, which is a big pain in the pitch. And one of the interesting things and hard things is supporting more chains. So creativity strikes again. We have been talking about Ethereum so far, but one of the things that decorates Ethereum is when it has a huge network spike, the gas price will increase dramatically, and it can be really expensive to run a transaction, actually. So people will figure out something what we call a L2 chain or level 2 chain. It's a blockchain on a blockchain. They basically take out the computation out of Ethereum. They make a blockchain-like working system where you also submit the transaction and everything. And when it gets processed, it gets packed and compressed with a lot of other data, and in the end, submitted to Ethereum. So you have that verification, that trust of Ethereum, but most of the things you would pay with gas is out of there. It also brings some issues with that, but the super cool thing is if a simple transaction in Ethereum costs $15, on L2 it would be a dollar or less maybe. But the problems can be like one chain recently made the transaction pool private, which made it that much harder for us to monitor our own transactions to help them out pretty much. And we have to have different setups for gas calculations per chain because one decides to go this way, one this way, but you have to pay both for Ethereum gas and for their gas and gas there, gas everywhere. And one of the most important things is nothing is certain. You absolutely never can approach a problem thinking, yeah, users are most likely not to be active at 3 a.m. In the next 15 minutes, everything can change. And most of my backend team is here, so if no one can react, well, good luck to us. So never approach the problem like that. I took the freedom to list out the things I see as pros and cons of the challenges we face, what is fun and what is interesting, and what can be a pain in the pitch. High demand and pioneering, you can really land a high demanding job and a high salary if that's something you're looking for. But something much more important, in my opinion, is you can be a pioneer in blockchain. You can leave your footprint in the code base, in the open source, which is really hard, but it's really mega fun. You really feel like you're having an impact. I worked in the corporate environment and for a bank, and it doesn't come near this, really. It's a really small community. You don't have to open a ticket on some site and wait for, I don't know, 7 years for someone to answer. You quite easily end up in a Telegram developer group where everyone wants to come up with a solution that works best for both sides. So it's really cool to have that small community. Everyone is kind of pushing each other and contributing. It kind of takes you back before the industrialization. It's full of riddles and challenges, and that's really fun to have. So you want only making basic CRUD systems, you will do something really challenging and really fun, and you will have to think out of the box to find a solution. For example, is that the gas, is that security, or something else? For example, a mega fancy storage saving idea will hit you for Solidity, and you're going to be mega happy for days. Human creativity, mentioned again, it goes on both sides. People and ideas are amazing. It's so cool to learn from it all. But on the other end, all those ideas sometimes come to bite you back, and humans also use their creativity to be malicious and to make harm to others, unfortunately. One of the things also to mention quite popular is arbitrage. Arbitrage is basically you go and, if you would make it a real-world example, you would go to an exchange to buy euros for Serbian diners, and you would run to another exchange before the price changes to utilize that difference and gain money. And one of the favorite things to me is the culture. The culture is really different. The decentralization culture is not something you're used to everyday life. For me, actually, it is still hard to adapt to it, and I'm adapting as I go, but I really love it and kind of can't wait to go even more deep. For the cons, The learning curve is big. I'm still struggling with it. It's hard, but fun. Poor documentation, in my own opinion, unfortunately. That some texts and some articles that are really good, unfortunately, don't apply anymore. And it's hard to keep up with the development and the documentation. But also, I'm sure that will change over time. The hype can be a bit too much. I was asked already on this conference, hey, what's happening with the hype? Is blockchain dead? Are you guys out of the job and everything? And true, the hype around some dApps can be too big because of some social media posts. And then not everything makes it, unfortunately. And then it can leave a bit of a bad impression. And the immediate application, unfortunately, you can't paste blockchain everywhere right away, right? But each day, it just gains more places to apply. To wrap things up, I wanted to quickly run through some things you might already know about blockchain, and you actually are not starting from zero. A lot of the software engineering areas align. Have you ever SSH'd into a server? I'm quite confident you have. Wallet is asymmetric encryption. You have a private and a public key. That's why you have those t-shirts saying, not your keys, not your tokens. If you don't have your private key, you don't owe them. But yeah, that's simply a wallet, just things you sign with your private key. Have you done distributed systems? If so, you understand more than fundamentals of blockchain because it's a distributed ledger. Have you touched on cryptography? If you have, you understand the fundamentals upon which blockchain is built on. Immutability, thankfully, it's gaining even more and more popularity, probably thanks to functional programming. The foundation of blockchain revolves about immutability, and its integrity is disputed if it's not immutable. Transactions and rollbacks, we can have the same in SQL, right? So if a transaction and a contract initiates a rollback and reverts sometime in the process, everything will be reverted and the state will be at its original value. Open source, if you like and you have contributed to open source, you're going to find yourself a really nice spot and you can walk around freely. Blockchain really thrives on open source. Do you know how to implement an interface? Then you can make your own token. You have something called ERC20 standard, and that's basically an interface you have to implement, and there you go, you have your own token. If you have done Java, C# or something, Solidity is really similar. It really isn't that hard to do. So with this, I would round up my talk, and I kindly ask you if you can scan the next QR code. It's really a feedback link for me. This is the first talk of this kind for me, so anything good or bad you have to throw at me, maybe not a rock, but that would be most appreciated. If anyone wants to ask a question or chat more, please find us on the first floor next to the beer so we can drink and have fun and talk about blockchain. Thank you very much.